Hey, good morning, everybody. How are you all doing today?
Wonderful.
John, I believe that about you. I chastised John in the first hour because he wasn't excited enough. So I'm glad you. I'm glad you're
I had to come back just to have a second try.
Thank you. You did a great job, John. Much kudos to you on that one. So, hey, I want to greet everyone here and just say welcome to Northbridge, whether you're joining us here physically on this campus or you're on a computer or a phone streaming the service
Daddy,
online.
I'll go out
there. Okay, you'll go out there in a minute, Dax. That's fine. So, as you can see, Dax has joined us because his mama and I didn't transfer just quite in time. So, anyway, we want to say we're so happy you're with us today and just... grateful for you to be here. We're starting to. You have daddy's keys. That's right, Dax. You do. You do. That's right. So, hey, without any further ado, why don't you stand up to your feet?
No, I'll take the phone. I'll take the phone.
So, stand up to your feet and greet someone around you, okay? You're a ham, Dax.
Shining the darkness, go.
Oh, There is hope. There is hope for you and I. There is life in Jesus Christ. This world.
Today we proclaim the truth through song. There is hope. There is hope. The reality is, you know, as a pastor here, I know intimately, I know keenly that many of us are facing circumstances that, you know, if you were facing them with a worldly mindset, with realistic, whatever word you want to use, common sense mindset, you'd recognize that you're in a hopeless situation. You know, all the X's and the O's, they just don't add up, you know? You are in a situation that you can't get out of. You have a bill that you cannot pay. You find yourself at odds with someone in your family or at work that just frankly is never going to get better. At least that's what, you know, you're saying in the back of your head as you come at it with a worldly perspective, as you come at it with a common sense perspective. But, you know, the truth of the matter is, friend, if you have Christ in your life, if you've submitted your heart, your mind to Jesus, there is always hope. There is always hope. And so right now we're going to pray and you know this. If you kind of are feeling like you're a bit in a hopeless situation, this prayer is specifically for you. So let's pray right now. And whether you're joining us in this room or you're online watching us from a distance, if you are one of those people that are saying, I feel like I'm hopeless, I'm not asking you to identify yourself, I'm not asking you to raise a hand or anything like that, but would you just whisper to God, God, help me. God, you know where I'm at right now. I need you. Here's another prayer. God, give me hope today. And Father, we come before you. And Lord, as many of us are here together or online watching, and God, the fact of the matter is there's some of us that just find ourselves because of family situations or because of disease or illness or job situations or work situations, whatever they be, we find ourselves in a with a sense of hopelessness. We find ourselves with a sense that we can't get out of this situation under our own power, under our own authority, under our own willpower. And Lord, we recognize that is a true statement. But Father, we have you. You have all the power. You have all the authority. You have all the resources at your disposal. And so God, we declare that we, by faith, are saying we have hope. We have hope today because your Son, who defeated death, who is resurrected from the dead, who paid the price for our sin debt, stands in the gap for us today. And we thank you for that, God. And we lean into that. In Jesus' powerful name, amen. Go ahead and be seated, and we're going to turn up the lights. And a couple of things, just so you know, we're going to spend a couple of weeks, just a few minutes each day for the next 2 weeks, talking about Harmony House. There's a big experience. Harmony House is moving. They're moving to an old hotel that's over there close to PFI off of Battlefield Road. And a group of us on Monday went out there and did some work, just helped clean up some stuff. And there's a picture of our work team. And Northbridge, you're just to be commended because, you know, one of the things I learned was that there were 9 entities in all of Springfield that have helped Harmony House get into their building. And Northbridge is one of them. And I think that's something commendable, something, oh, I don't know, Sarah, I don't know if it's right to be proud as a church. You know, we're supposed to be humble, right? But I'm proud of you guys to be one of 9 groups to come and help this group. Now, another thing, I received a phone call this past week that was enlightening and disturbing all at the same time. It was informative also. It was from a business director, a business professor at Evangel University. And she was calling because she was tasked and was partnering with Harmony House to develop a plan to get more churches involved in their job, but get more churches involved in Harmony House. And be honest with you, I mean, just the kind of guy I am, I was just like, ma'am, I don't know. As I was talking, I was sitting there going, I don't know that you've got the right person, right? I don't know that you want to speak to Northbridge Church. I think there's a lot of other churches that are doing a lot more things for Harmony House that you should be speaking to, because her purpose was to pick the brains of a few of these people to figure out how to mobilize the faith community in Springfield, Missouri. And this is one of the things she told me. She said, no, Tony, you're actually wrong about that. And she started giving me some numbers here, which was pretty interesting. According to her, there's 439 churches in Greene County, or faith groups, or, you know, pockets of believers. There's 439. She said, out of those 439 churches in Greene County, there are 29 churches that support and give to Harmony House, period. And I thought, wow, that's kind of sad, you know, there on that end. And then she said, and here's the thing, Tony, that of the 29 churches, Northbridge Church is in the top 6 faith communities to support this institution. And yeah, Sandy, that's I can't help but say that I was proud of our group. I was proud of this group of people being willing to step in to folks who a lot of people ignore and a lot of people let them fall in the gap, but and a lot of people say they're worthless or they deserve where they're at. And you as a faith community are saying, no, we're going to step up and we're going to help. We're going to help in the name of Jesus. But also, Sandy, I got to tell you, I was sad too. Because let me tell you, I know what we give through our Going Global budget. And yet we have probably at the end of the year about 100 or so manpower hours invested in Harmony House. But let me just tell you, you know what? That's a drop in the bucket, you know? And to say that, okay, that little amount of serving that we do and that amount of funding that we give every month to be in the top six speaks volumes to me that then I felt like, man, okay, is God using me to help coach and help challenge other churches to step up so that next year, wouldn't it be cool if next year we were in the lower six? You know, that they're coming back to us saying, hey, Northbridge, you need to get your head in the game here because now you're in the bottom percentage because so many churches are giving and so many churches are doing things and stepping in the gap for these people. That's what I want to see happen. You know, I want to have that conversation with us one day. So, you know, next week we're going to have Esther come in and she's going to share with us because I'll tell you, when we walked through Harmony House, it was beautiful. It was absolutely, what an incredible facility. It will be, and it is going to be, the best facility in all of Missouri for women that are dealing with abuse, domestic abuse. I mean, that's not me saying, you know, making some grandiose promise. I'm literally saying it's going to be the largest one in Missouri, which is pretty incredible. And just, it's beautiful. It's a beautiful place. And so I'm so glad that we're a part of that. And you're going to hear more about that next week. But also, I come today bearing good news in that you all don't have to endure hearing me preach today. Hey, there is not. These people love me more than the first hour, John, because in the first hour, people cheered. People actually cheered when they heard that. And you guys, I'm hearing your silence not as you don't care. I'm hearing it as stunned. You were stunned and shocked by that. So instead, what we've done is we've invited Sarah Forhetz. Some of you know her as Sarah Sheffield, to come and speak. And so one of the things I did, you know, she's a investigative reporter. And so I decided to be an investigative reporter this week. And so what I did was just learn some facts about Sarah that I just want to share with you all before she comes up and speaks. I Googled her name to see if I could, you know, I've known Sarah for a couple of years, but I know her in a certain capacity. I thought, let's hear what other people have to say about her. And so this is what I found. I thought you guys would find this interesting as well. Sarah Forhetz loves news and always has. Her desire to get to the bottom of things started as a young girl. Everyone in her hometown of Fort Gibson, Oklahoma, knew when they talked to Sarah, they would be asked a million questions. That inquisitiveness continues to this day and has turned into an award-winning career for her. Sarah joined the KY3 news team in February 2005 as lead reporter for Ozarks Today. Sarah is an award-winning reporter. She won a Mid-America Emmy for her coverage of the rebuilding efforts of Haiti back in 2010, and she also won an award for the investigative reporting from the Missouri Broadcasters Association as she uncovered the used car dealership that was rolling back the odometers, defrauding dozens and dozens of people. She won an award for that also. Now, I can tell you this. These are things, some of her accolades that are online about her. But having the chance to know Sarah, I can tell you as her, one of her friends that she is a committed Christ follower. I can tell you she is devoted to her community and seeing her community reach for the glory of Jesus Christ. I can tell you she's a committed wife and mother and sees a value of the ministry of how she is raising those kids and growing a family with her husband Ethan for the glory of Christ. And this is a person who God has touched. And so I just thought it'd be appropriate for us to get to experience Sarah and hear a word from her today. So with it, not any further ado, why don't you just let her know how much you appreciate her.
Thank you, Pastor Tony. Thank you guys for having me this morning. I got to know Tony a little bit at Victory Mission. I don't know if you know it, but he's on the board there. So the work that you guys are doing at Harmony House and that he's doing at Victory Mission is truly incredible, reaching out to people that without Jesus, they literally have no hope whatsoever. Many of them just in desperate situations, but we serve a God of the impossible, and just like that song proclaimed, there is always hope. And if we have life in Jesus Christ, there is hope. I have seen some hopeless situations completely turn around and take a turn that was just out of left field, completely unexpectedly, because of the power in his name and the power in life with Christ. Thank you so much for having me. It's really an honor to be able to speak with you this morning. As Tony mentioned, I have a passion for this community. I feel like God has planted my family here in Springfield. My husband and I met here. We came here with no real connection to Springfield, but God has planted us here. And those who are planted in the house of the Lord will flourish in his courts. So it's awesome to see that you are planted in a church. And my hope is that after today's message, that you will go out into your zone, your sphere, your neighborhood, your workplace, wherever God has led you to, and that you will share the gospel of Jesus Christ, and that you will invite people to get planted in this house. Because if you've been here for any amount of time, if you've experienced the love and the power of Jesus in this place, you know that there is power in corporate worship. There is power in planting yourself in the house of the Lord. Psalm 92:10, one of my favorite verses, because he who is planted will flourish in his courts. And if you want a life with purpose and that is flourishing and not floundering, then you will be planted into the church, because God loves his church. You know, a lot of people, it seems, these days are very comfortable sitting on their couch and being like, oh, I believe in God and I love God, but I just don't love his church. No, if you love God, you love the things that God loves. And God says, I will build my church and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. So get someone with you next week. Bring them and fill up these chairs. You can let them know that you have amazing coffee. So that right there is enough to get me in a church. All right, if you have your Bibles, open them to Acts chapter 8. I'll give you a moment to do that. Acts chapter 8. Passage this morning starts in verse 26, and it is the story of Philip and the Ethiopian eunuch. Some of you know that story, some of you don't, but it is my favorite story in all of Scripture. There are a lot of good stories, but this one I feel like it's so relatable, because Philip is just like you and me, just an average Joe who hears from God, because if you are a Christ follower, then he is speaking to you. The question is, are you listening and are you willing to obey him? All right, here we go. Chapter 8. As for Philip, an angel of the Lord said to him, go south down the desert road that runs from Jerusalem to Gaza. So he started out and he met the treasurer of Ethiopia, a eunuch of great authority under the Candake, a queen of Ethiopia. The eunuch had gone to Jerusalem to worship, and he was now returning. Seated in his carriage, he was reading aloud from the book of the prophet Isaiah. The Holy Spirit said to Philip, go over and walk alongside beside the carriage. Philip ran over and heard the man reading from the prophet Isaiah. Philip asked, do you understand what you're reading? The man said, how can I unless someone instructs me? And he urged Philip to come up into the carriage and sit with him. The passage of scripture he had been reading was this. He was led like a sheep to the slaughter, and as a lamb is silent before the shearers, he did not open his mouth. He was humiliated and received no justice. Who can speak of his descendants? For his life was taken from the earth. The eunuch asked Philip, tell me, was the prophet talking about himself or someone else? So beginning with this same scripture, Philip told the good news about Jesus. They rode along and they came to some water. And the eunuch said, look, there's water. Why can't I be baptized? He ordered the carriage to stop, and they went down into the water, and Philip baptized him. When they came up out of the water, the Spirit of the Lord snatched Philip away. The eunuch never saw him again, but he went on his way rejoicing. Meanwhile, Philip found himself farther north at the town of Azotus. He preached the good news there and in every town along the way until he came to Caesarea. So I read this story, and there's so many observations that we get from this. Philip is an average Joe, and he's having an average day, just like the majority of us do when we wake up and hit the ground, right? But he hears from the Lord, because God says, go south down that desert road from Jerusalem to Gaza and run alongside a carriage that is going to be on that road, and at the end of the day, you're going to have led this man to the Lord. And, you know, it can seem like, oh, this is a Bible story, and that's not really how God works. And I would say, au contraire, It is how God works. He's sending all of us to run alongside someone's carriage. You know, for Philip, he was going from Jerusalem to Gaza in the middle of the day, which is not normally when you would travel. In the heat, you would go either in the morning or at night. And he was going an alternative route. It wasn't really on his path, on his journey, or the quickest way from point A to point B. But God is telling all of us to run alongside that carriage, and he's making the appointment. He's giving us the divine appointment. The question is, are we willing to be obedient? Are we willing to go down the road from Jerusalem to Gaza when it seems a bit out of our way, or when the sun is a little bit too hot, or when we're going to be running up alongside a man who doesn't look like us, act like us, doesn't have the same culture as us, the same skin color as us? But when God says to go south down that desert road, he's calling all of us as followers of Christ to put our hope and our trust that he's going to show up, that the Spirit of the Lord will give us the words and wisdom in the moment to love that person, to explain and interpret Jesus to them. And this morning, really the question that this passage begs is, whose carriage are you running alongside? In this race of life that we're all on, this journey that we're all on, whose carriage is God calling you to run alongside? And, you know, in our own knowledge and interpretation and understanding, and maybe for some of us, we're not like talkers, but, you know, we can let that trip us up, and we can be like, well, we'll leave that for the really bold personality, or the guy who went to seminary, or Tony can go out and reach everyone that, if I can just take you to Tony, and then while he's preaching, you'll hear from God. And while that's great, while it is biblical to be planted in the house, there are many people who would never set foot inside a church. They just don't have seemingly any interest until they meet the Son of the Living God. So whose carriage are you running alongside? My hope is that this morning you will just open your hearts to hear from the Lord on who are you appointed to? You know, we all are on this journey. We all have this zone. You're not at your workplace by accident, or in your family or your neighborhood by accident. God has divinely placed his children to partner with us, to share of his love and his faithfulness and his forgiveness, and that repentance, a repentant heart, can just have a fullness of life and of joy. I became a Christian 10 years ago, and God has radically transformed my life. I would say that I was exposed to the right things as a kid. My mom was a single mom. My dad was in prison, and so she had us at church whenever she could. And, you know, I didn't really have an interest in the things of the Lord. I'm by nature skeptical. As Tony told you, I'm super inquisitive, and it's like I need... So I thought, something tangible to like grasp onto. And you know, there are people in our path that God is sending us alongside to run by. And you think, well, they don't have any interest. They don't have any, you know, reason to believe. Like their life looks so normal and fantastic. And I just don't know that they want to hear about Jesus. They don't even seem to need him. But in Philip's case, when you hear from the Lord, you have to trust that he's going to show up, and that his voice is going to become your voice, and that if he's calling you to go south down a desert road, and he's giving you an appointment, then God himself will do the speaking. 2 Timothy 4:2, preach the word, be prepared in and out of season, correct, rebuke, and encourage with great patience and careful instruction. You know, it's not always seemingly our season to be willing to be inconvenienced. But can I tell you that this was an inconvenience for Philip's trip? If you read on in Scripture in the book of Acts, you'll see where he's going, and you'll notice that this little trip from Jerusalem to Gaza was not part of his plan. It was not part of his path. But when we hear from the Spirit of the Lord and we go, and if you're a believer, you've been sent, you already have the commandment to go. You don't need to be told again, like, do I go to them? Yes, you go to them. And I'm here to tell you that evangelism has to speak. You know, Philip, you could infer from this passage that perhaps he was not the best segwayer, because how often is it that we run into people who are literally reading Scripture, and all we have to do is come up alongside and interpret it for them and lead them to Jesus? But this Ethiopian eunuch that we meet in this chapter was reading Scripture. And then in verse 35, it says, so beginning with the same verse, Philip told him the good news about Jesus Christ. And the beauty of that is that God will give us a segue. You know, it might not look like someone is reading their Bible at their desk at work, but this says to me, you know, maybe Philip wasn't the best segwayer. The point is that God will give all of us a segue. All of us have the ability because it's not our own ability. It's Christ in us who gives us the ability. About 6 months ago, I had the opportunity to go to Africa, and I was like super excited because I knew that God had clearly orchestrated the trip because I have three kids under the age of 7. They're 3, 5, and 7, a husband who works nights, and I'm just like, you know what? There's no way that I could possibly go to Africa. This group asked me to go with them, and I'm thinking, God, if you want me to go, that would be awesome, but I need the money, the logistics, and like it just became clear that God was working all of these things out and was orchestrating this plan for me to get to go. And I'm sitting there and I'm praying and I'm like, God, what do I have to give to these people? Like, I don't know what you'd want me to share, what you want me to say, what you want me to do. I don't have like a skill set that's really like transferable. You know, I can talk, like that's what I do for a living is talk, but I don't even speak their language. And I don't know, I was just really nervous about the trip and knowing that God was sending me, but not really knowing the purpose of it. And I get on the plane and I'm looking at my ticket and I go to sit down and I notice that there's a man sitting in my seat. And it's a long flight, so I'm thinking, do I get him out of my seat? Do I tell him, like, I didn't know, you know, I don't fly a lot. So I walk up and I was trying to communicate to him, like, hey, dude, you're in my seat. Can I sit? But he didn't speak English, so I was like, okay, forget it. Like, I'm just going to go and I'll sit elsewhere. And then if someone comes and kicks me out, then I'll like go back and like press the issue. So I go sit down, make myself comfortable. 10 minutes go by and another man walks onto the plane and I'm seeing him looking at his ticket and I'm just watching him. And he like goes to sit down in his seat, what was supposed to be his seat. And he had the same experience. The guy whose seat that he was sitting in was also did not speak English. So he's like looking around and I was just kind of laughing because I was like, I literally just did the same thing. But he ended up sitting right beside me. So here we are. No one kicked us out of our seat. So we both were just sitting in the seat that we weren't supposed to be sitting in. And we strike up a conversation and start talking. And he is a professor. I find out he's a professor. And he asked what I did. I said, I'm a news reporter. And so we started talking. And he's like, oh, well, I was in the news recently. And I was like, oh, awesome. What were you in the news for? And he was like, well, I've actually been studying my whole life to figure out why the giraffe's neck is so long. And I was like, awesome. That sounds fantastic. I mean, I'm thinking, are you for real? But he was definitely for real. And no offense if you're like a geneticist, biologist person, that's fantastic. But I'm like, oh my gosh, I cannot intelligently talk to this man. Lord help me. But he was explaining that, I mean, he was middle, like probably around 65, if I had to guess. And, you know, he had devoted his life seriously to this cause. And so we get to talking, and long story short, we talked about politics and all these things that you can't talk about as a reporter in America. So it was like, beautiful, I love to talk politics, and I'm in Africa, let's do this. So anyway, we're talking, quite a lengthy conversation. And then I finally said, so are you a Christian? And he was like, oh, yeah, I'm a Christian. And I was like, oh, awesome. So when did you give your heart to the Lord? And he quickly started talking about his mom's faith as opposed to his own faith. And so in my mind, I'm thinking, okay, he's probably not actually a Christian, like even though he is entitled, like he has not had like a transformational living relationship with the God of heaven, you know? And so I just continued talking with him, and he kept talking about his mom. And, you know, I'm assuming that she had passed away because he was an older gentleman, and he was talking about her in past tense. And so I said, well, clearly your mom and you had a really close relationship. And he was like, yeah. And he's like, yeah, I just remember her. She would always get up, and I could, like, hear her praying for me, and she prayed all the time. And, you know, he was kind of getting sad about his mom. And I said, you know, it's interesting that we would both be sitting here on this plane and that I would be next to you because neither one of us are even in the seat that we were supposed to be sitting in. And here we are. And I'm here to tell you that everything your mom taught you is true. And he kind of looks at me a bit perplexed. And I'm like, you know, she lived her life, you know, loving the Lord, praying for her son. And it's interesting that she has now passed away, but her prayers will never die. And so I'm letting you know that God has sent me on this plane, divinely orchestrated that I would sit by you to let you know that he loves you, that he goes out of his way for you, and that everything she taught you is true. And most importantly, that you can see her again. And he kind of looked at me perplexed, and I said, well, where do you think your mom is? He's like, well, I think she's in heaven. I said, so you don't really believe in God, but you believe in heaven? Because without God, there's no heaven, right? And he's like, well, I believe she's in heaven because that's where she told me she was going. And she believed so much that that's where she'd be, that that's where she is. I said, well, you know, I believe that she's there too. I said, but I also believe that she wants you to come see her again. But to do that, you have to put your faith in Jesus Christ. And he was like tearing up by this point, like took off his glasses. And I just knew that this was it. And I was like, oh, Lord, help me. I'm going to lead this man to the Lord. So I said, can I pray with you? And he said, oh, no, no, you cannot pray with me. No, I'm not interested. And he like just put up this like shield, you know. And, you know, as disappointing as it was in that very moment, you know, we still had some time left. And as we're getting off the plane, I said, hey, professor, can you promise me one thing? And he said, what's that? I said, promise me that while you're in Tanzania for the next 3 months studying these drafts, that you will ask the God of heaven to reveal himself to you through nature. And he kind of looked at me like I was nuts. And I was like, you know what? Like, God can reveal himself through nature. Like, read in Job chapter 12. It happened, you know? And so God is not in a box. Like, he sent me to tell you, you know, that he loves you and he cares for you and he wants a relationship with you. And just ask him to reveal himself. And, you know, I don't know the end of that story of Tanzania. But what I know is that when I get to heaven, I have no doubt that one of the first people to greet me will be that man's mother, because her prayers never died. And I fully believe, I'm fully confident that the God of heaven will continue to send people to run alongside his carriage who are willing to jump in to a conversation with a man who is way more brilliant than me, or a person who doesn't look anything like me, who doesn't have the same culture, the same belief system, the same language in some cases, the same skin color, the same gender identity. But if we're willing to run alongside the carriage, then we can trust that the God of heaven will continue to send people along that path. And if you have a wayward child, a wayward son or daughter, a wayward father or mother, who's running beside their carriage? And whose carriage are we running beside? And if we want to trust the God of heaven that someone will run alongside our dad or our mom or our brother, then we have to be willing to be the answer to that mom's prayer. You know, I don't know his mom. I've never seen her before. But I know that when I get to heaven, she will thank me for running alongside and doing my part. It's a very small part that I do. I simply watered a seed. But the seed is there, and it's beneath the surface, and someone else will run alongside that man, and I know that I will see him in heaven. And I want to challenge you this morning to run alongside someone's carriage. God will bring someone to your mind whose carriage that you are intended to run alongside. You know, Pastor Tony can't do it all. There are people in your life, in your zone, who only you can speak to. And the evidence of that is that God put you there. He gave you the neighbor. He gave you the mom, the dad, the kid. He gave you the coworker, because your ministry is to that person. And if we can all run in our zone and cover our zone, then we don't have to worry about even our loved ones who perhaps we feel like have no interest and they're not around us anymore. And we've lost our influence in their lives, because we can pray and our prayers do not go unanswered. God answers our prayers. And he says, if you ask anything in my name, it will be done for you. And you know, that can trip a lot of people up, because we can ask for things and we're like, well, is this God? Is this me? Well, sometimes it's us and sometimes it's God. We can see that as evidence in our lives when something happens or when it doesn't. But you can rest assured that if your prayer is for salvation, that you're absolutely praying God's will, because his will is that no one would perish and all would come to him for eternal life. And I find a great comfort in knowing that the prayers that I'm praying for my coworkers to be saved and my family members and my friends, even if I'm not the one running alongside them anymore, that God himself will send someone south down that desert road. And the question is, are we obedient? Are we willing to be inconvenienced and go south down a desert road that is not on our trip from point A to point B? You know, Philip was able to run alongside this man. He gets baptized, and then it says, and immediately he was snatched away. And the eunuch went on his way rejoicing, and they never saw each other again. You know, sometimes we run for a season of life. We're in a season of running a race alongside a person, and it's a long season. And there are other times where it's just an immediate obedience, where if we will share the gospel vocally, Philip could have been kind all day long. Philip could have given him every single dollar in his pocket. That doesn't save a person. To bring a person to the knowledge of Jesus Christ, it's spoken. The word is spoken. We have to be bold with our mouths, not just with our money and not just with our kindness. We know that it's the kindness of Jesus that draws us, but evangelism always speaks. Show me the person who became a Christian because someone was so nice. They have to know the motivation of our heart, the motivation, the reason I'm kind, the reason I'm giving, the reason that I'm reaching out to the Harmony House is because I serve a God who is a God of hope and truth and light and love, and there's hope for your situation, and there's hope for your life to turn around if you meet the living God. So may we be bold and speak boldly the mysteries of the gospel so that all will come to him and no one would perish. Luke 21:15, for in that moment, I will give you words and wisdom that none of your adversaries will be able to contradict. There's a couple of different versions of that verse, and I just love it because we can get, you know, too concerned and too nervous about, well, what will I say in the moment? What will I do? And we have to tell ourselves, because it's true, that it's not loving not to tell. If we love people like Christ loved them, we let them know that there is an eternal hell and an eternal heaven, and that it's a simple decision. You're either in or you're out, you're hot or you're cold. No more of this lukewarm stuff, because we have to identify with Christ, and God will give us words and wisdom in that moment. You don't have to prepare in advance. The Holy Spirit that is in you is drawing all people to himself. And all we have to do is be willing to go south down that desert road and willing to jump up in someone's carriage, regardless of what they look like, regardless of what they sound like, regardless if they seem interested or not. Run alongside them and God will do the rest. John chapter 4, verse 37 says this. You know the saying, one plants and another harvest. And it's true. I sent you to harvest where you didn't plant. Others had already done the work, and now you get together the harvest. You know, his mother, this man's mother, laid the seed. She laid the groundwork. Her prayers laid the groundwork. And you know, some plant and some harvest. But we have to be willing and ready to bring in the harvest. You know, the fields are white, the fields are ripe for harvest. And we have to be those laborers. We have to be willing to labor for people in prayer and in purpose and in our place. We have to realize that God has appointed each of us to his own. You know, I mean, your coworkers who seem so uninterested and so lost, I have several of those, but one of them in particular, I was at Chick-fil-A, this was like a month ago, and this lady came up to me and was like, hey, are you that girl from the news? And I was like, yeah, and said hi, and I thought that was going to be the end of the conversation, and she just tears up, and she said, I want to thank you for ministering to my daughter. And I'm thinking, who's your daughter, you know? And she told me who her daughter was, and it's a girl that I work with, and she was like, you've had this huge impact in her life. And I'm sitting here thinking, are you kidding me? Because this girl seems completely uninterested in anything of God. But clearly, she's had a conversation with her mom about me, you know? And it just goes to show you that, I mean, I speak the gospel to this girl. I let her know that hell is for real and heaven is for real. And it's not out of a spirit of like, I want to scare you into relationship with the Lord. It's the reality of the situation. It's the reality of the day that we are living in. I mean, you watch the news and it births in me an urgency that time is so short. It's so short. And we have to be more concerned about loving people and to do that, speaking Jesus to them than, oh, I don't want to offend them. And what if they don't agree? Well, what if they don't agree? The question is, what if they do? What if they're interested? What if all they need is someone to say, yeah, can you jump up here with me and explain this to me? Because how can I understand it unless someone explains it? Evangelism always speaks. I want to end on this story. My niece, she's 21 now, but she just turned 21. When she was 13 to 14 years old for that year, she was in Oklahoma living there with my brother, and we got a call. I got a call at work, and it was my first day back to work from maternity leave. So I had a six-week-old baby at home, my first child, which is terrifying, as you know, many of you know. So this lady on the other end of the line said, hey, we have your niece, Chloe, and she's in foster care. And if someone does not come and get her, within the next 24 hours, she'll become like this property of the state and go into a group home. So can you come get her? And I was like freaking out inside. I was like, oh my goodness, are you kidding me? Ah! You know, so I find my husband in the newsroom and I was like, hey, Ethan, you know, my niece is in foster care and she doesn't have anybody to take her. Like, we have to go get her. So we load up her car. We drive to Oklahoma, pick her up. She comes back to Springfield and, you know, she was here for a year. And so in that time, we were trying to expose her to everything good that we can. I mean, we had her in church every Sunday, every Wednesday, you know, anointing her room with oil, praying over it when she's not in there, just asking that God would meet her in a very, very real way. And a year goes by. We have to go back to Oklahoma for an appointment with the judge. And he sends her back to live with my brother, who's not a believer and an addict. And I'm like, no, are you kidding me? Like, God, for real? Like, I know that you orchestrate all things, but this is crap. I mean, she's doing so well up here. She's thriving. Her grades are good. She's loving the church. She's plugged into the church. Like, I was so disappointed because when she's there, I mean, she can't even get to church because she's not old enough to drive and my brother won't take her. And I'm just like so disappointed and honestly just angry at God, just so mad that he would take her from us, because I knew that the influence that we were having on her was a good thing. And, you know, she goes off, fast forward a few years, she goes to college on a super secular campus and same college that I went to, and just partying and drinking and doing the whole scene, you know. And I was just like, God, like, please draw her to you. I mean, I was just like on my face every morning in prayer, like, please draw her. I love her. Like, she's like my heart, you know. And it's just so disappointing because she was so close, you know, when she was here. And then all of a sudden, just to have it all ripped away. And lo and behold, right before the semester was ending, some girl on campus who was like 18 years old walks up and said, would you want to go to lunch? And she doesn't even know Chloe. And Chloe was like, sure, you know. So they go to Chipotle and have just a very brief conversation. And the girl says, what would happen if you gave your life to Christ? And she had no evidence on the outside that Chloe had any interest in anything of God. She was simply willing to hear the voice of the Lord and obey. And Chloe, sitting in Chipotle in Stillwater, Oklahoma, starts crying and said, you know, my aunts have told me about that, and I want to do that. And that was right before semester ended. She ended up going on an eight-week mission trip down to Florida with this Christian, like campus crusade type Christian group from school. And her faith is radically transformed. She will be in heaven, people. I'm like, whoa, praise Jesus. But this was a girl who was just willing to go talk to this stranger who looked nothing like her. I mean, they don't have any common interests. They're two college kids living very, very different lives. But when you're willing to be obedient to the Spirit of the Lord, regardless of what someone looks like on the outside or the, in, you know, whatever you interpret about their willingness or readiness to hear about Jesus, you just share. Because even if they don't respond, it doesn't matter, because he's the one who draws them. He's just using our voice. You know, it's not our ability or lack thereof. It's God in us. And, you know, just to see Chloe's walk today, I mean, and she's still a baby Christian, but just to see her living out her faith and to see God showing up in her life blows my mind. It blows my mind. She is night and day a different person. And, you know, I don't know who God wants you to run alongside, but I know that he is bringing people to all of our minds that is, they're in your zone for a reason. And, you know, in this story, we see that Philip had no more time left with this man. You know, the Spirit of the Lord snatched him away and they never saw each other ever again. You know, there are people in your life and in your zone today who will not be there tomorrow. You know, time is so short. And that's not really a scary thought to the believer, but there's a world around us dying and drowning and broken in sin and destruction and headed on an awful path, and they just need the hope of Jesus, but they need someone who's willing to be obedient and speak boldly and make known the mysteries of the gospel, because it's a mystery until someone tells us how to interpret Jesus in their lives. Will you bow your heads with me? Dear Heavenly Father, God, we just thank you so much, Lord Jesus, for your word. We thank you, God, that you have prepared for all of us, Lord, a race to run and a journey to set foot on, Lord. And we just ask in the name of Jesus that you would draw all people to you, God, that you would just give us a boldness. God, we know that it is your word and your wisdom. And we just ask, Lord, that you would just do what only you can do, Lord Jesus. You draw hearts and minds. And Lord, I just ask, God, that you would draw people to you, God. I ask that you would raise up this church, God, just to be a beacon of light in this community, God, that people who are planted here, God, would know the importance of corporate worship, God, and to get others involved, Lord, that it would not be enough, Lord, to sit on the couch and sit on the sideline, God, and just enjoy you all for themselves, but God, that they would boldly share you. And God, I just pray for that wayward son or daughter or coworker or friend or mom or dad, God, that you would draw their hearts, and Lord, that you would give us divine appointments that we would take, God, that you would draw all hearts to you, God, Lord, that no one would perish, that everyone would have eternal life. And God, I pray that you would birth in every single person in here an urgency and a boldness, God, to share of your love and your grace and your forgiveness. And God, just that you would fill us up, God. Lord, fill us up today, Lord, that we might pour out your spirit tomorrow, God. Lord, I just pray, Lord Jesus, that you would draw people to you, God, that people would come to this church, that they would come to the cross, Lord, and that they would meet you. And God, that you would just raise up this church, raise up the families in this church, oh God, to be a beacon of light, Lord, in this community. God, to point others to you, Lord. And we thank you for your son. We thank you for what you've done for us, God. We ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
I invite you to stand and sing this with us as we sing what we've heard.
I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turn. Thank you. Jesus is our refuge, a shelter from the storm, a hope to those who call. Name of Jesus is our fortress, a safe place to run, a hope unchanged.
Amen. Okay, go ahead and be seated. Real quick, you know, one of the thoughts that I had as Sarah was talking is really when it's all said and done, what we're about and what gets us in trouble and what the big difference that makes us who we are is that we agree with Paul in that we are here because we have the hope of the resurrection. That's ultimately when you just cut through everything, cut through political speak, cut through class warfare, cut through all this moralism, all that stuff. Christians are Christians because we believe and have the hope that one day when we are laid in the ground, our Jesus is going to come back for us, and he's going to resurrect us from the dead, and we're going to experience life eternal with him. That's what makes a Christian, separates a Christian from a non-Christian, ultimately, when you cut through it all. And so Sarah, I invited her to come today to share with us, because what we're going to begin doing is we're going to start a three-week series in the next 3 weeks called Life with Purpose. And the fact of the matter is this. I don't care if you make $1 million. I don't care if your face is on TV. I don't care if you have more tweets than anybody else in the world. If you don't have Jesus in your life, you really don't have life. And you can chase after all the things in the world, friends. You can chase after all the glamour. You can chase after all the money. You can chase after all the importance in this world. But if you don't have Christ in your life, you're missing out. And so we're talking in the next 3 weeks about purposeful life is life in which we, as Sarah challenged us today, are willing to run alongside that chariot in our lives, whether it's someone in your work or in your family or in your neighborhood or someone you meet. And how do you begin to have that conversation? How do you make an impact with people that don't have a hope of resurrection? So join us for the next 3 weeks as you're going to be challenged to identify those chariots next to you and do something about it as God speaks into your life, as God whispers to you direction. So one last announcement and we're moving on. I did what I said in the first hour, and that was I bought my wife a ticket. The two of us are going to the Valentine's banquet on February the 11th. That means we have two Sundays left. You have two opportunities to buy tickets. Now, I'm speaking specifically to men. I'm looking, there's some men behind me. There's men all over here. Men, shame on you if you require your wife to go buy your Valentine's Day ticket, okay? So I want you to go out. I did this already. Go get a ticket. You and your wife, this is like, I don't know, the 7th or 8th Valentine's banquet. What's that? What are you, am I missing out on something? Okay. So I thought I was messing up. You got called out. You guys got called out. So go get a ticket. It's going to be the 11th. It's going to be an awesome time. The theme is Come Sail Away. So there you go. Lots of things that they're going to be doing with that. So you'll want to be a part of that experience. Hey, may you experience this week chariots around you. May you identify them. May you have the wherewithal to join those people in their chariots and speak words of truth and words of the resurrection. Go in peace. You are dismissed. Have a great week.